We are live today. This is the Bitcoin Cash Debt Site Friday live stream. I'm George Donnelly. Today, my guest is Marc Falzon. How are you doing today, Marc?
Good. I like that little accent at the end there. That makes me feel so European. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh. Oh, so how do you pronounce your last name?
I pronounce it like a boring American, just Falzon. But whenever there's anyone who adds some frill to it, I'm all for it.
So are you from like the East Coast of the U.S., Philly, or where are you from?
Yeah, I grew up in New Jersey. So yeah, Northeast.
Okay. Yeah, I'm from Philly, actually. I grew up in the
Northeast. Oh, are you?
Yeah, Northeast part of Philadelphia. So
yeah, I mean, Marc, when you're...
Yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say something stupid. When you're in the Northeast and you're in New Jersey, you either say you're from New York or you say you're from Philly. You never say you're from New Jersey. It's sort of like the rule. And I would always say Philly when people would ask me.
Yeah. So Marc, over the last couple of weeks or so, has been out spending Bitcoin Cash in different, so in like Philadelphia or New York, or where have you been spending it?
So right now it's been Philadelphia. So what I did is I went out there having never used Bitcoin or Bitcoin Cash, having never known what Bitcash or Bitcoin Cash is. I mean, even now talking about it, I'm not 100% clear. I'm very new to everything. So David basically challenged me to live on crypto for 3 days in Philly, which I've done. And I'll be continuing to do this in other cities. So one of the next places I'll be going to is actually Venezuela to live there only on Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash. So that's been sort of the past week. And then kind of going on in the future, I'll be doing more of this.
Wow, you're going to Venezuela. Okay. So yeah, what, you know, so when David, this is David Bond, I guess, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So when David suggested this to you, what grabbed your attention about it?
Well, the truth is, I'll be a little crass here and say money. In the sense that David said, hey, if you do this challenge and you're successful, if you go 3 days without spending any money or credit card, I'll cover the Bitcoin and the Bitcoin Cash for that 3 day period. So that was sort of a fun bet that he gave me. And the reason he gave me that bet is because David is a friend of mine. I've known him for a number of years. We've traveled together, and he's always been attempting to get me interested in cryptocurrency. And to be perfectly frank, it always seemed too complicated. I'm a simple guy. I don't really understand technical things. So it was always something that I had a vague understanding. But again, it seemed so technical that it was never something I wanted to do. But you know, David's challenge kind of took me over the edge to try it. And well, I'm sure we'll talk about some of my experiences actually using it over the past week or so. But I'm definitely interested in it now that I've had some experience. But that initial push, it took David.
Cool. Great work, David. So what was the first thing you did? You downloaded a wallet or?
Yeah, I downloaded a wallet, the Bitcoin.com wallet specifically, and I recorded myself. I'm not sure if you saw that video, but I recorded myself installing it and using it as a complete beginner with absolutely no help or input from anyone. So it was like a 30-minute video of me looking like a bigger idiot than I already am, trying to figure out what I'm doing. I didn't know that there was a difference between Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash. I didn't know if Bitcoin was, I mean, this is really just how little I know, if it was centralized or not, if there was one official Bitcoin group, sort of like a PayPal. So yeah, I kind of fumbled through it in that video and ended up getting a lot of people on Twitter angry.
Wait, so what were they angry about? Was it the whole Bitcoin BTC versus BCH thing or what?
I mean, yeah, they were angry at that. They were angry at the fact that I was using that wallet, Bitcoin.com wallet. Apparently that's contentious. they were angry that I didn't know what Lightning was and all of these technical terms. I mean, you know, people, I found that people with anything that is a passion will obviously, you know, have their preconceived ideas of what is the right thing and what is not. But I think that the value in me fumbling around with that app is that those preconceptions really have no meaning to people who don't know anything. And if you want people to get interested in cryptocurrency, first off, you want to be supportive, but more importantly, you don't want to bring your own preconceptions to the table of what's good or not. What's good is what's easy for someone like me, in my opinion, anyway.
Nicely said. There's a thing in the whole crypto space where people get wrapped up in their old grudges, in their prejudices, in their ideas of how everybody else should be doing it. And I think those people should recognize that they are completely off track when somebody new comes in and they start making that person feel dumb, you know?
Yeah.
Like, really, the new people are the ones who have the most to teach us, I think. Because really, if the products and, you know, if people can't understand what's happening, then that means that we have to do a better job, right? Because for this sure. has to be accessible to the mainstream, not just to some anonymous cypherpunk, you know, who uses Tor, you know.
Yeah, George, that's a great point, especially because if, you know, you know a lot more about the space than I do, and I'm sure a lot of your listeners do as well. If you want people who are technical coming into Bitcoin, then it makes sense to argue about these technical things and to, you know, I get tweeted at about these like long paragraphs with words I don't understand. I don't know what a blockchain is. You know, these people have good intentions. They want me to do what they think is best, but if you want people who are just the mainstream coming in, that's not going to be effective. And what I've come to realize over the past few days and the past week or so is originally my understanding of Bitcoin and cryptocurrency was, you know, it's like a stock. You buy it and it's for your own self-worth or preservation or financial self-worth. Maybe not self-esteem. but what I came to find out is, especially with Bitcoin Cash, there is a larger humanitarian element to this that's frankly very touching. And to encourage that aspect of it, where people such as people in Venezuela can, you know, use this currency and be part of the global financial conversation, it's going to require me and my mom to be on Bitcoin Cash, and it's going to require more people to adopt it outside of just the very technical. Or maybe not.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm 100% down with that. 100%. You know, the work that I've been doing for years is all about onboarding regular people, you know, merchants, consumers, people who send remittances, and figuring out how to make it more accessible and useful for them. So you downloaded a wallet, you got some Bitcoin Cash. Did people gift it to you or did you buy it?
Okay. So a few things. One, Well, originally David sent me, I think it was $50 or $20. And he did give me one tip. The tip he gave me was to take a photo of myself with my QR code and post it on Twitter saying that I'm doing this. And I got tips. I got donations. And I've never experienced something like that before. It was, you know, I told my mom about it later. She's like, why are they giving you money? Why are they tipping you? Well, it's because I'm doing something that is new and they're supporting something they care about. Anyway, that was really kind of amazing how, let's say, supportive the Bitcoin Cash community is. And I'm being specific with that because the Bitcoin community, I've kind of run an experiment over my past few days where I post one Bitcoin QR code and one Bitcoin Cash QR code. The coin QR code, I think, got two donations over the entire weekend, totaling $2. And the Bitcoin Cash got, I mean, I'm not going to count it, but it's easily over 30, 40 individual tips. And the amount is, I mean, I got a $50 tip. I got, it's really crazy. I've never seen something like that before. So anyway, yeah, that's where my money came from.
Yeah. People in Bitcoin Cash are very oriented to the whole utility thing. And we often refer to Bitcoin, you know, BTC as Bitcoin Core, because really that's the name of the development team that essentially took it over three or more years ago. But yeah, I mean, you got $2 in Bitcoin Core. Well, that might cover the transaction fee.
Yeah, as I found out.
Oh yeah. So tell us about that. What happened there?
Let's see. I went to buy Starbucks. I went to buy a coffee. And this was on my first day of my challenge in Philadelphia. So I bought a gift card, and it was a $15 gift card. And again, I used Bitcoin for that and saw, hey, I'm getting charged a $3 transaction fee to get a $15 thing. And you know, I'm thinking to myself, well, it's ridiculous. First off, I didn't understand, you know, at that point, I already understood that cryptocurrency was not centralized. So I was thinking to myself, who the hell is taking that fee? That's a bigger fee than PayPal would have taken, or Stripe would have taken, or a credit card would have taken from a merchant. So that had me very confused. But beyond that, I'm just thinking, how are you able to do small transactions? How are people who don't make lots of money living in smaller countries, or, you know, lower economy countries, how are they able to use this currency? And the answer is, well, as come to find out, Bitcoin isn't really, let's say, from my perspective, intended to be a currency, which seems odd from my perspective. But, you know, again, what do I know?
Well, just about everybody in Bitcoin Cash finds it odd as well, because all of us, you know, I got into this in 2011. Some people got in before me, others got in after me. But those of us who are in Bitcoin Cash, we're all in this to find utility, to use it as a medium of exchange, cross-border, you know, very small fees, you know, so it's accessible to everyone, even people who earn just $2 a day or whatever. Yeah. And so the whole thing over the years where the Bitcoin Core developers kept the block size to 1 megabyte, which limited how many transactions could happen in any given amount of time, and the whole fee market, which happened, which is where they encouraged people to basically bid with their transaction fees to see, you know, to get their transactions through processed, you know, more rapidly. All of that was just alien. That's just alien to us in Bitcoin Cash. Yeah. It makes no sense at all.
I mean, it's definitely alien to me. And I heard about the idea of bidding transactions. First off, I don't know how to do that. But even if I did, I'm just thinking, if I want to go somewhere and use my Bitcoin, let's say, you know, I buy something from someone on Craigslist, I'm not going to sit there and wait an hour or 3 hours or whatever for a transaction to go through, because I set the price low enough that it makes sense to do that transaction. It's just not going to, it's not going to happen. And part of the reason that Bitcoin, or let's say cryptocurrency, is sort of attractive to me beyond sort of what I've alluded to before, which is the humanitarian aspect of it, is I make my money selling digital courses. So not involving Stripe or PayPal or a third party is pretty attractive to me as far as, you know, selling goods online. And with Bitcoin, those transaction fees, it wouldn't be feasible.
What's the average price, you know, of, you know, when you sell your courses?
So the courses I sell they range from $47 to $200 to $400. So, you know, I even have, you know, I do blogs. So I have blogs that cover my passions, and I even have a blog that's about tea. So sometimes tea sells, and I would rather take cryptocurrency and not get merchant fees. But yeah, again, with Bitcoin, it just wouldn't be possible because the transactions are so small for those. It's like $5, $10 worth of tea, and I'm going to get a $3, $4 charge on the, well, the person paying for it would get that. They're not going to do that. They're already paying shipping.
Yeah. I mean, even, you know, using something like PayPal or Stripe, you know, let's, I mean, these fees, it's usually a percentage and then a fixed fee, right? But let's say it comes out to 4%. So on a $47 course, you're paying about $1.88 in, you know, merchant fees, transaction fees, whatever. But, you know, if like you're already just on a $15 Starbucks gift card, you already paid $3 on that. That's more than 50% more expensive.
Yeah. And that's because I got that gift card. You know, I was originally going to get just a $5 gift card. And then it's like, whoa, never mind that. That's crazy.
Is insane. And that's why Bitcoin Cash exists. Because, you know, here, like if people can look at bitcoinfees.cash and see that, you know, our fees are usually below a fifth of a penny on Bitcoin Cash. So it's barely even noticeable. You know, maybe you've had the experience, you spent Bitcoin Cash and you look at the wallet and see, oh yeah, the fee shows as 0.00.
Yeah. Yeah. When I saw that, I said, oh my God, maybe they could raise that up a little bit. I wouldn't mind. It's so low. But what the thing is too, you're talking about money and transaction fees are one thing, but even to me, that's not the main problem. The main problem is complexity. If you want me to adopt something that is completely alien and foreign to me, like cryptocurrency, and you want me now to bid on sending fees or bid on the fee that I want to send the money, there's so many layers of complexity. And as a beginner, again, I'm sorry, I wish maybe I had more patience to learn stuff, but I don't, at least I don't. Let's leave it at that. So
you don't owe anyone an apology. It's up to the Bitcoin Cash ecosystem to make things simple for new people.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, Bitcoin Cash was simple. And even using Bitcoin was simple with my wallet app. But again, it was simple because I had to pay that high fee. And people are tweeting at me saying, well, you don't have to pay the high fee. You just do all these other complicated things. And maybe they're not complicated to you, but to me, they're complicated. They're new. And I'm already overwhelmed trying to just buy a Starbucks coffee. So I'm not going to do all that. It's just not going to happen.
Yeah. I don't know if you saw, there was a tweet that made the rounds on RBTC and elsewhere from Andreas Antonopoulos. And you may not know who he is, but Andreas has been a very prominent proponent of Bitcoin for many years, giving many talks, educating many people. Very well respected, but unfortunately, Andrea seems to have gone down the wrong path because he made a tweet recently precisely about how he avoids high fees by doing all these crazy, crazy things, you know, to pay payroll around the world. And I even read it three times that I wasn't sure what he was doing. And it just goes to show the whole narrative in the Bitcoin core space. People are just lost. They're lost. They don't get it. I don't understand, you know.
I mean, I guess it depends on what your motivation is. If your motivation is to keep things small and elite and keep most people like me out, then those complicated elements are furthering your goal. They're successful. If your goal is to get more adoption, mass adoption, as I've seen people say in the space, you can't be adding elements. You got to remove elements.
I think you're right on. And I think that, you know, the only thing that I can conclude is that the Bitcoin core people want to keep it small and elite. And I know, you know, I want to onboard millions, ideally within a decade, you know, hundreds of millions of people. And I know a lot, you know, I think everybody in Bitcoin Cash shares that same goal. So yeah, So you gave a tip. I saw in Starbucks, you gave a tip. How did that go? Can you describe that experience?
Yeah. So with the wallet app I use, it's very easy to tip people or give money. And part of, I guess, the ecosystem that I experienced, which is people were tipping me, it's nice to pay it forward. So Starbucks, Uber, a bunch of restaurants that I went to, they literally just either take a picture of my QR code and then download the app and then they get the money, or I can even text them, which is really cool. It's almost like sending a picture. So they just give me their phone number and I text them a tip and they click it and it automatically goes into their account. So yeah, people were excited to learn about it, especially when you're giving them a tip.
Were they amenable to downloading an app? Was that unfamiliar for them, or how did they, when you were, because like I, when I think of giving somebody a tip and I'm like, you know, you got to download an app and you know, you got to figure, you know, I got to orient you to this new thing.
Okay. So that's a good question. They kind of went through a mini version of what I went through, when I had them download the app, but they have the advantage of me being there. So I don't know what their interpretation of getting that was. I mean, I went to a coffee shop and tipped a girl and she had never heard of the word Bitcoin before. Like, at least I had heard of it, but it was super easy. I mean, you just go to the website, you click download from bitcoin.com, you get the app, it opened. And then I literally just showed her like, here, scan my code, and it transferred the money and she got it. So, yeah, it was pretty easy and seamless, to do that. And I'm sure she'd play around with it on her own, because now she has some money in that account. She's probably going to want to learn how to spend it.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. Yeah. This is a point that I've made, over and over, and some people are kind of skeptical. Like I think that probably between about 95 to 99% of people in the world, and here I'm taking into account people in the developing world, of course, which is a great majority of humanity, have never heard of Bitcoin. What do you think? Where would you put that?
True. I would, yeah, no? I would agree with that. I would agree with that. And if they heard of it, it would only be in very slight passing and maybe not even distinguish that it's different than some stock or some, you know, ticker somewhere. Most people don't know about it. I would totally agree with you, but they're very open to learning if there is a reason to, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I ran a big crypto adoption effort in 2018-2019 here in Colombia, South America, where I live. And we also had other teams. I actually ran teams in 8 countries and 20 cities. And I personally onboarded thousands of people, and I also trained other people to do it. And, you know, in my experience, you know, I would sometimes frequently mention Bitcoin. And I would say, you know, it's kind of like Bitcoin. Have you heard of Bitcoin? And literally 99% of people had never heard of Bitcoin. They had no clue what it was. And the few who did, you know, their experience was mostly actually scams. Because scams are rampant in the developing world. It's just out of control.
That's unfortunate. Yeah.
Yeah. But all of that adds up to the enormous opportunity that I think sometimes people don't see. Because we're so close to all of this, you know, and we're so familiar with it, which is, since 99% of people haven't heard of it, that means that the current crypto space with its market caps and its products is tiny. And if we can break out of that and onboard millions of people, that's an opportunity really for any crypto.
Yeah.
To just rock past all the others, you know?
Well, it was funny. I tweeted that I tipped someone Bitcoin Cash, I think it was, during my 3 days. And they were being a little bit, let's say, not friendly and saying, well, that's not sustainable. It's not sustainable to go around and get people to, you know, adopt crypto or learn about it by tipping them. And I'm thinking to myself, are you crazy? Are you out of your mind? Of course it is. You just have to do it in the right situation. So for example, I'm not going to walk around downtown and just tip everyone in the world a dollar. Obviously, that's not scalable. But what is scalable is if I'm at a restaurant, although COVID, once that ends, although people still eat outside, at least in my area, at the end, when you go to tip, you can say, hey, I can tip you 20% or I'll tip you 25 on Bitcoin. Oh, cool. Tell me about it. You can tip at a coffee shop, $1. That's scalable. I'm going to tip anyway. Why not just tip a dollar Bitcoin Cash? There's no fees. It's easy. So there's situations where you're going to be obligated to tip. So just make it a new option, and then you're getting someone else on the system. And to me, that seems really valuable, because the more people that are on the system as someone who, let's selfish, then it benefits me, because now there's more people using it. I can use it in more places, more businesses use it. It's better that way.
Yeah. And that's network effect. The more people that are connected to a system, the more valuable that system is, you know, the more valuable each participant, the more value each participant in the system can get out of it. And also it's interesting that you say that, because that comes back to a problem that I've seen in crypto, which is distribution. Only a few people have crypto, and we're at a situation now where people who got in early have huge amounts, and they're a very small percentage of humanity. You know, 99% of humanity has zero. And so, like, I think there has to be mechanisms for distributing Bitcoin Cash or SLP tokens or whatever to huge numbers of people. Because once people who are outside the system really gain nothing from the system. They have no incentive to participate in the system. But once we bring them into the system, they're a part of it. Now they have incentives.
Yeah, and just to touch on what you said about the network effect. Well, that network effect can't happen with Bitcoin, because I can't tip my Uber driver $5 Bitcoin. I can't tip the coffee lady $1 Bitcoin because of the fee. So to get that network effect where you get more people to adopt the currency, you need it to be so cheap and so easy that even if I forget my wallet and I don't want to tip Bitcoin Cash, but I don't have cash on me and I need to tip the coffee lady, then I have Bitcoin Cash and it's cheap and it's easy. Everything has to be cheap and easy if you want it to spread, you know, or maybe not. Again, I don't know.
Agree. I agree. You're 100%. I mean, I've been working at this for years and studying it, and you're dead on. You're dead on. I was going to say something and it slipped my mind, but I want to talk about, you mentioned humanitarian. So you have a humanitarian interest. And the humanitarian aspect, and I would say the humanitarian aspect of Bitcoin Cash, is this idea that, you know, we can onboard the world, we can serve the world, we can have billions of daily active users. And this can be accessible to everyone, everywhere, you know, no matter how much they earn, no matter, you know, as long as they have an internet connected device. What is the humanitarian aspect that appeals to you? You know,
so from what I understand, and again, it's limited understanding, but you know, I'm very fortunate to be born in America and to have safeguards, family, and you know, access to whatever opportunity I need, really. But not everyone has that. And you think about countries like Venezuela, or even people like the Uyghurs in China, who are being completely eradicated because of their heritage. These people get financially cut off from the world. I mean, especially in Venezuela, especially in places where, you know, communism and socialism have eradicated their economies and whatever other problems they have, I don't know. But those people individually who could join the global conversation and could financially support themselves and protect themselves and their family, they're not going to be able to do that with their local currency. It's just not happening. But if they're able, again, with just the internet, which most people have, maybe not everyone, maybe not some of the Uyghurs, but I would think they would have access to an internet cafe too, can provide services and can provide work and can get a currency that is theirs and is not going through the hands of their officials. And I think that's really important. And again, it's easy to sit back and be in America and say, well, you know, high fees are okay with Bitcoin. But if you were on that other side of the world, you wouldn't be saying that. That's for sure.
100%. Yeah, there's an economist, Peruvian economist called Hernando de Soto. I don't know if you have heard of him, but he wrote a book called The Mystery of Capital. Highly recommended. Really, I think it's essential reading for this topic. Basically, he went to a bunch of developing world countries, Egypt, his native Peru, a whole bunch of different places, Philippines, and he discovered that financial exclusion, financial limits, trade limits, huge delays in bureaucracy with registering property, with forming a business, led to the creation of what is called today the informal economy. And actually, most people in the world who are working work in the informal economy, literally billions of people. Here in Colombia, more than 60% of jobs are in the informal economy. In sub-Saharan Africa, in some places, it's as much as 90%. In Thailand, 70% of the economy is in the informal economy. This is a situation where people don't have access to banking, to credit, to loans. You know, the typical case is where there's a farmer. So this is just a kind of a prototypical example. Farmer in Peru, he has control of his land, his plot of land, but it's extremely expensive for him to get legal title, expensive, drawn out process. So he can't get legal title to his land because he doesn't have the resources to do it. Mm-hmm. So because he can't get legal title, he can't borrow against that land in order to buy seeds to plant his crops or to invest in fertilizer or to buy farming equipment, right? So it's like financially the dark ages.
Yeah,
and that's why so much global poverty exists. Mm-hmm. And so since I discovered Hernando de Soto a few years ago, this topic has fascinated me. It really has.
Yeah, I've never
had a lot of the answers
that it would be that high. Yeah. So many people would be living like, but it makes sense, and it's so invisible when you're here.
Yeah, that's one of his hypotheses is that, you know, basically in the United States, it's and, you know, other developed world countries, it's fairly easy to access to, for example, like you wouldn't think of buying a house and not doing a title search and not, you know, making sure that the house is registered in your name on the property ledger, at the city office or whatever. You know, and forming an LLC, you can do that online for $99 and it'll be done in like a week. But he, for example, Hernando de Soto, he hired a team of research assistants to form the equivalent of an LLC in Peru. And they worked full time for like 89 days to get it done.
Oh, my God.
Going around to all the government offices. It's unthinkable. It's unthinkable.
Yeah, that's absolutely crazy. That's crazy.
One of his conclusions that I found really interesting is that there are actually more assets. The value of the assets in the developing world is actually greater than that in the developing world, but they're not properly registered on ledgers, and so people can't make that value liquid. Yeah. They can't borrow against it, right? And so form capital.
You know what this means? It means we can't complain about waiting an hour in the DMV line anymore. They have 89 days for an LLC.
Yeah.
Puts it in perspective.
Yeah. Although I don't like waiting in line at the DMV either.
Me neither. I'll take that over 89 days, that's for sure.
Yeah. So you have this intention to go to Venezuela.
Yeah.
So tell us more about that.
Okay. So long story short, during my challenge, I had a lot of people reach out to me. And one of them, one of the people who reached out to me was a, I believe a booking company, and their headquarters is in Venezuela, and they support themselves through Bitcoin Cash primarily, I believe. And he said, hey, come down here and try your challenge. Oops, Siri is popping up. He said, come down here and try your challenge out, see how it goes. I'll give you a place to stay. I'll meet you at the airport. And to me, that sounds like an adventure. And I've actually never been to South America before. Mm-hmm. The most south I've gone is the top border of Mexico. So yeah, we'll see what that experience is like. I'm sure it'll be very eye-opening. But apparently in Venezuela, they are really adopting Bitcoin Cash pretty heavily. Apparently a lot of places accept it. And I know there is a place where you can hire VAs online that are all mm-hmm. Venezuelan, which I'll be using actually when I get down there, maybe even to hire someone to be my camera person. So yeah, it'll be really exciting. I'm not sure when it'll happen, but hopefully soon.
I keep waiting for the regime to fall, frankly, over there.
Yeah.
I've had a lot of team members who are located in Venezuela, and things can get pretty nuts over there. But I think that once the dictatorship falls, the opportunity to rebuild Venezuela, the economic opportunity, is going to be enormous. Mm-hmm. It's just going to be gargantuan, because Venezuela used to be not just one of the wealthiest countries in Latin America, but in the world.
Wow.
It's rich in natural resources. It was rich in human resources, but unfortunately 4 million or more people have left the country. Mm-hmm. You know, and I've talked to a lot of Venezuelans, like most of them have come to Colombia, and I've talked to a lot of them, and they really don't have any intentions to go back.
I mean, that's the really hard thing, is when you cripple your people leave. And it's I was watching this TED talk once about immigration, and you think about these jars of jelly beans, and you think, well, yeah, people leave, but people stay behind. But the problem is, the people who leave are the people who are the highest earning, who are the most capable of fixing the home country. They're the ones who have the means to actually go. So a lot of the problems that, as you pointed out, the human capital, those people flee. And then who's left behind is it's tough.
Yeah. Yeah. The most highly skilled, the entrepreneurs, the most ambitious, the most well-educated, they have opportunities elsewhere.
Exactly.
In fact, yeah, last year we noticed here in Colombia that the type of people that were coming over from Venezuela, and I really like Venezuelan people in general, some really nice people, friendly, hardworking, very hardworking, very, very much hungry for new opportunities. But we noticed that some of the most of the new people who were coming over were not coming from the large cities anymore. They were coming from the small towns and the countryside, you know. Mm-hmm. And so it was even harder for them, because not only were they moving from one country to another, but they were moving from rural areas to urban areas, and they did not have the work experience or the education, or they were just not prepared for the demands of city life, or to have the skills that were in demand, you know, in Colombian cities, for example.
Yeah, it's tough.
Very challenging. Yeah.
What brought you?
All right. Well, by the way, say it again.
What brought you to Colombia from Philly?
Well, after college, I went to college in Chicago, and I rented a room after college, and the owner was a Colombian. And at that time, this was shortly after they killed Pablo Escobar. Mm-hmm. And, a lot of Colombians had left due to all the strife of that situation. And so he said, yeah, Colombia's great. You got to come to Colombia. And basically he nagged me for like 3 months. Yeah. And so I said, what the hell? You know, I'm young. I'll give it a try. And then like his family kind of basically adopted me, and it's just such a beautiful place here. You know, when you come down to Latin America, you should come over to Medellin. It's just a gorgeous city. It's called the City of the Eternal Spring. And, you know, it has spring-like weather all year round. The mountains, the people are really nice. It's a great place. Yeah,
I've actually heard the same. A lot of my friends travel down or live in Colombia. And it's one of the places that I definitely need to come by. So when I do, we'll have a coffee together.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And we'll pay for it with Bitcoin Cash.
Absolutely, we will.
Yeah. All right. Well, so just to wrap it up, do you have, you know, you came into this space, you know, kind of fresh, with fresh eyes, a fresh perspective. Can you give us like two or three suggestions for how we can have a better experience for new people?
That's a really good question. I think that the initial steps, I would say, okay, there's two things now that I have a moment to reflect. One is to make the apps more user-friendly for someone who's never used it. And a lot of those things I pointed out from my perspective anyway in that initial video that I did. But I think the other part about it is there needs to be more content that's not technically aimed. More content on YouTube about people using it, but from an emotional standpoint. There's something emotional about using Bitcoin for the first time that's fun. There's something emotional about doing challenges, Bitcoin challenges, and then showing those videos. Doing content that is less about the financial benefits of cryptocurrency and the technical, let's say, benefits of it, such as, you know, it's high security or it's whatever, I don't know. But more about just the lifestyle behind cryptocurrency and the humanitarian aspect of it. That, I think more of that is beneficial, because that, in my opinion, is what would have gotten my attention and would, in my theory, get other people's attention who are not technically, let's say, you know, inclined, like my mom. You know, the only reason she cared at all about Bitcoin or Bitcoin Cash when I told her about it, because she knows nothing about this stuff, is that A, I was able to buy a gift card from Starbucks and get coffee, and B, that a random person online sent me a tip. Like, those two things really excited her and made her want to download the app. So more of that stuff.
So more benefits.
More benefits, say. More lifestyle, I'd say. Again, if you were going to get more people like me.
Yeah, I think we definitely do. You know, maybe more illustration, more real world use.
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
All right. All right. Hey, so we just have a quick comment here from Omar. I'll put up on screen. I don't know if you see that, but Omar's a real Bitcoin Cash fanatic. He says he's loved your crypto adventure, wishes you good luck with Venezuela, and is really enjoying you know, what you have to say today.
Great. Nice meeting you, Omar. Thanks for your comment.
Yeah, Omar's a great guy. I like him. All right, so Marc is going to actually drop a new video in about an hour. Is that right?
Yeah, 1 p.m. EST, so that's exactly an hour and 15 minutes from now. The three-day crypto adventure in Philly will be online. So
cool. Watch, and you can find his channel at his name on YouTube is Marc Falzon.
Nice.
He's also
the first one. I like the first one.
Falzon.
Yeah, it's perfect.
Yeah, so that's Italian, right?
It's actually Maltese.
Maltese. Oh, okay. Maltese, yeah. Interesting.
Yeah, I thought I was the only person that had that name, Falzon, growing up. Falzone. But when I went down to Malta, everyone had it. I mistook someone there who had my last name as being a relative of mine. I'm like, oh my God, we're related in some way. And he's like, no, you don't get it. Everyone here is Falzon. And he was right.
So guys, definitely subscribe to Marc on YouTube, youtube.com/c/MarcFalzon. He's going to drop that video today. And Marc, it has been a great pleasure speaking with you today. Thanks so much for your work over the last couple of weeks promoting Bitcoin Cash. I look forward to, you know, seeing more from you and, you know, talking with you again in the future.
I love that. George, it was really great meeting you and learning so much and talking. I'm going to take you up on that offer for a Bitcoin Cash coffee once I come down to Colombia.
Please do. Please do.
Perfect.
All right. Let's keep building Bitcoin Cash.